Volodymyr Yermolenko with our media monitor. He's here from the Internews, and as it
is also a professor of political thought, as you pointed out. So we like to turn to him to get insight into everything that's being thought about and considered.
Especially how the so Volodymyr, tell us how the foreign media reported on the anniversary of Maidan.
Maidan. Well, it's interesting that I was expecting that foreign media will be paying much more attention than paid actually, and I would say that the attention of the foreign media, of international media, was less focused than attention of Ukrainian media, of course. And here, when those newspapers who covered Maidan events, who covered Maidan anniversary, they mostly were making some kind of a dark picture, I would say gloomy picture. And the first example I would draw attention to is an article in Washington Post, basically made by Associated Press. And here we have mostly, you know, criticism that demands were not fulfilled, that there is a war, that if Maidan did not happen, then that there would be not war probably, etc., etc. Many other articles are in this way, and I think they're underestimating some positive changes that have taken place. For example, that Ukraine had two elections, that Ukraine reloaded its authorities, and that Ukraine has actually started reforms. But another thing is, I would draw attention to an article by Ukrainian writer Andrei Kurkov, which was published in BBC, which is kind of trying to give a more hopeful picture, more positive picture. And here he tries to roll back a little bit and try to understand what happened during this year. And he says he remains optimistic, he remains positive about the next events, and says one very important thing, that basically Ukraine would not be able to face the pressure from Russia without the European Union. Now, what is important in these developments after Maidan, I think, is the role of volunteers, the role of civil society. And here we have the international media drawing more and more attention to that. And I would draw your attention to New York Times, the article in New York Times by Andrew Kramer, who is basically analyzing what the volunteers were doing and how they really try to change the society. Now, if we turn to international scene, here we got very interesting piece made by Die Welt, the newspaper Die Welt, who is analyzing four different strategic answers to Russia's aggression from US, from the EU, from Germany, and from Ukraine. Here, there are two points which raise concern, I think, very, very dangerous points. That the article is saying that the US strategy is now to leave Ukraine in a gray zone between the West and Russia. And the Germans' policy is now, you know, to follow the containment policy with Russia in Europe, but at the same time to talk to on other issues on the world scene. So also trying to kind of a reconciliation. So these are trends which are raised by this newspaper, which seem to be very, very important. Two other things is basically the way how Russia tries to split the West from within. And here two articles, one in Le Monde and another is Der Spiegel. Der Spiegel is writing how Russians are now splitting the coalition, the German coalition from within, the Grand Coalition. And Le Monde is making the overview of Russian networks among the intellectuals in Paris, starting from this, you know, cathedral which is now being built in Paris.
What that mean, that we don't know that much?
There is a great cathedral worth 100 million of euros which is now being built in the center of Paris, the Russian cathedral, the Russian Orthodox cathedral, which is intended to be the center, you know, of the Russian influence in the heart of Paris. Now, and the final topic is Russian politics, and here very interesting interview by Vladimir Putin for TASS, and the thing he is saying is the phrase which made a headline to this interview is that we are stronger because we are right. You know, and this, you know, this Russian rhetoric that basically no debate is possible, no discussion is possible. We feel that we are right, and therefore we're strong. And another article I would like to draw attention to is the interview by a Russian opposition activist Olga Romanova for a Belarusian newspaper, by the way, about some splits that are possible, you know, inside Russian politics and for example, the fight between different clans, between FSB clan and the army clan. So let's hope that there is not that solid in Russian politics as it seems to be.
How argumented is that? Because that's exactly something interesting, because everybody sees Russia as something very solid. There is Putin.
Yeah.
And, you know, he is the guy who decided.
Well, she says that there is a clan of FSB Sechin, there is a clan of the army Shoigu, there is a clan of Putin and Putin's friends, the Rotenberg and all the other guys. And she's arguing that the clan of Putin's friends is weakening because of the sanctions and because of the, you know, because of the some attacks from these other clans, etc., etc. So she's saying basically that the Putin's influence is weakening and there is a fight between Sechin clan and Shoigu clan. But this is all hypothesis, I think. But
turning to another issue, you know, some of the pieces looking at the anniversary at the start of Maidan, what's the legacy that they say has been taken away? I mean, it seems to have been evaluated mainly positive, but what are the concrete results that people are looking
well,
at?
Well, they're paying too much attention, I think, well, too much attention, to my mind, too much attention to economic issues. Mm-hmm. They're saying that Hryvnia...
Or Ukraine has not been successful.
Then. Yes. Ukraine has lost, Ukrainian Hryvnia has lost 50% of its value, that basically Ukrainian economy is on the brink of collapse. The Economist published an article saying things are that bad or even worse than that bad, etc. But I think it's underestimation a little bit of what have been done because, the legacy of Maidan is basically is that Yanukovych has gone, this power has gone, and nobody could have predicted 1 year ago that this would happen. I think the Western media a little bit focusing too much attention on this. And the coalition agreement, by the way, is not paid too much attention, which I think it's wrong because it's a very interesting document, because basically five parties are taking very detailed commitments, the 70-page long document with a clear commitments with clear deadlines.
Is this the first time that's been done in Ukrainian
yes,
politics?
Yes, of course. Yes, I think yes. In this term, yes, because if you look at all the, you know, pro-EU reforms which the civil society is expecting, you look at the coalition agreement, it's there.
Mm. All right, well, we'll have to...
Yeah, we will prepare. We're now about to write the explainer about the coalition agreement, what is there, so follow our medium. And also I encourage my colleagues to tweet the link to the medium on the media monitor Volodymyr has made for us. And we thank you very much for being with us, and we expect you to give the great analysis of what is written in foreign media for us.